Feedstock prices, which have become increasingly important for the petrochemical industry competitiveness over the past few years. The shale gas revolution in the U.S. and the rush to ethane is changing the worldwide landscape as advantaged feedstocks will become predominant in the petrochemical industry. Our next speaker will discuss the role of feedstocks at the core of a competitive petrochemical strategy. Please welcome Mr. Philippe Soquet, President, Refining and Chemicals, and member of the Executive Committee at Total. Mr. Soquet has been with Total since 1990 and was president of Gas and Power Division prior to his current position, in which capacity he also sat on the Group Management Committee. Please welcome Mr. Soquet.
Your Highness, Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, very good morning to you, to all of you. It's really an honor for me to be with you. I must confess that I hesitate to say that it is a pleasure, because in fact, as you might be aware, we lost our chairman and CEO, Christophe de Margerie, 3 weeks ago. And without this loss, Patrick Pouyanné wouldn't have been appointed as a new CEO of Total, and I wouldn't have been appointed president for refining and chemicals. But nevertheless, we have to continue. Life has to continue. Total will continue. And we have so many friends, so many partners in this part of the world, but I can say, yes, finally, it's a real pleasure to be with you today. Subject of my presentation today, yes, will be the feedstocks. So it has already been a subject that was tackled this morning. But clearly, feedstocks are to be considered at the core of petrochemicals competitiveness. On this chart, you can see on the left side the cash cost of ethane cracker in US or Middle East, compare on the right side to the cash cost of naphtha cracker be in China or Europe. And you can see that the cost is going from 1 to 3, and therefore you can imagine that even if there are other factors for competitiveness than the feedstock, US and the Middle East petchem sites that have advantage feedstock will have a decisive competitive advantage going forward. So where does US feedstock advantage is coming from? Of course, in Middle East, we have known for years that this part of the world was gifted with privileged feedstock. But US, of course, is a new phenomenon in town since now some years. You can see the evolution on the left side of the price of naphtha and in blue, and the price of ethane in the red. And what we realized was with what we called the shale gas revolution, which ended up by being much more than a gas revolution, because from dry gas we went in the US to produce wet gas and even oil from shale, and this led to an increased production, leading in fact to a higher gas production and higher ethane production, up to the point that the price of ethane today is as low as the price of gas. And you can see now the gap of price between naphtha, be it in Europe at around $850 per ton, compared to US ethane, which is at less than 200. And therefore, even with oil price reduced by 30%, you can imagine that the gap in competitiveness will remain for the time being, and we'll see for the foreseeable future. On the right side, you can see that North America has already started to get benefit from this advantage feedstock, and the operating rate of the crackers there has been increased a lot, when in Europe we have started to suffer from this competition, and Europe has started to see a decline in its ethylene olefin production. Question, of course, might be, will this competitive advantage of the US last? Our answer tend to be yes. And on the left side, on this chart, you can see the blue curve, which is the forecast of gas production, and the blue envelope being a potential to produce ethane in the US from this gas production. And the red curves are our forecasts for ethane demand. And yes, our answer is that this competitive advantage in the US should last for the foreseeable future, at least until 2030 and even beyond. And when you consider the new project of ethylene olefin production in North America on the right side, you can see the credibility that we attached to the growth that we can see with an ethylene production which should increase from 31 million tons per year today up to 41 million tons in 2020. At the same time, in Europe, so we are facing competition from the US clearly, and the reaction in Europe has been a growing use of other feedstock than naphtha, and we have started to crack more and more LPG and mainly butane. And this is the blue part that you can see on this chart, which is going to grow up to 2020. And we also are trying to use more and more ethane, but of course to a more limited extent. First, because we have limited availability of ethane in Europe. We are importing gas. Our domestic production is declining. For the time being, it seems very unlikely that we will be in a position to develop shale gas in Europe, at least the big way. And therefore, ethane will have to be imported, and therefore the economics won't be obvious for such development. On top of that, we could add that the amount of capacities that can be fitted to accept ethane in an economical basis are very limited, and therefore this is why we are forecasting a slight decrease of the ethylene capacity in Europe. China, in China, this is a very different situation. Well, first, China is still benefiting from the high growth of its market. Of course, which is driving more and more new projects to feed this growth. And on top of that, China has a possibility of reaction for low feedstock for its petrochemicals plants with coal. We have seen since many years now the coal price being stabilized or even declining on the international basis. And this has increased the pressure on domestic production in China, and especially the coal production, which tend to be stranded inside of China, in Inner Mongolia or Shaanxi. And coal to olefin projects have started to be a reality, and we have already around 5 million tons of ethylene, which is produced from CTO, and a lot of projects now are being considered. Around 50% of new ethylene projects in China are based on coal, We are part of this movement as of Total, and we are studying with our partner CPI, a world-class CTO project of 800,000 tons of olefins. Of course, the concern of this project is the environmental performance. And on this chart, we have compared the performance of CTO project to traditional steam cracker. On the left side of each square featuring water consumption, CO2, SO2, and NOx production, we have compared on the left side, on the far left, the performance of our project based on our technology to the performance in blue of the existing CDO project. And what you can see is that on CO2 production, our project should be 30% less emitting than current productions. But of course, we will produce, or we would produce, more CO2 compared to existing steam cracker. And if we decide to go on with this project, the FID of this project should be taken next year. We'll have to compensate for the CO2 that will be emitted. But clearly, on the other environmental parameters, be it water consumption, be it SO2 or NOx, you can see that our project should be much more environmentally friendly than the existing CTO, but also, which might be a surprise to you, much more environmentally friendly than existing steam cracker. So overall, what is the consequence for Middle East and especially for new projects? On this chart, we have been comparing the costs for new cracker producing ethylene based on different technology. On the left side, you can see the cost of a Middle East cracker that would be based on naphtha, which clearly for us doesn't seem competitive. And on the in the middle, you can see a range of projects based either on CTO for China, or for Middle East, based on mixed feed, 50% ethane, 50% LPG, compared to US ethane cracker. And all of these projects are in the same ballpark. And our conclusion is that mixed feed cracker in Middle East are still to be considered for new projects. They are perfectly competitive compared to US ethane. And on the far right, even if we are aware that the availability of ethane in Middle East is scarcer, nevertheless, clearly the case for this ethane cracker in Middle East is still very compelling, and this is still the best competitive technology. In Europe, apart from trying, in fact, to make the feedstock more flexible and to use more and more light feedstock like LPG and for, as I said, a very limited percentage ethane, there are other ways of capitalizing on the low feedstock. And one way is to use synergy between refining and petrochemicals on a site where you combine the two activities. And this is one area of improving the profitability and the competitiveness of European plants. And one example is the use of refinery of gas as a possible cracker feedstock. This is what we have been doing in Antwerp, where we will be, in fact, cracking some 350 kiloton of refinery of gas that will be replaced by natural gas at the refinery. And by doing that, we should generate additional profit of $60 million per year. So it's clearly one way for European petrochemicals to resist. But we have to be aware that this is a limited amount that can be captured. So to sum up my presentation, we could sum up the forecast that we see for the petrochemicals future. And you see on the chart our various forecasts depending on the area. And clearly, we see an advantage to the area that can benefit from competitive advantage feedstock. So North America on one side, as I say, going from 31 to 41 million tons per year around 20. Middle East will still enjoy a very healthy growth, going from 25 to 30. China will benefit from the coal to olefin project to go from 16 to close to 30. But Europe will need, in fact, to resist, but will not be in a position to grow. So clearly, advantage feedstock is clearly one factor and one very key factor for the future competitiveness of petrochemicals. And on that basis, we still think that the Middle East has a bright future ahead of him. Thank you for your attention.